Our next step is to install Cartopy, a library that provides cartographic tools for Python. We can identify this module just by Googling Cartopy. First, we'll Google Cartopy. And in this case, it's the first hit that I get on this particular search. We'll then click Documentation, and we'll pick the latest version, in this case, version 0.13. You can explore the documentation page to learn more about this library. The first step for us is to install the library. Find the Getting Started section on the page and click Installation Guide. We've been using the Anaconda Python distribution throughout this course. One of the benefits of this distribution is that it makes it easy to install new packages. We will not go into the details here, but instead we'll just follow the instructions from the web page. Working on a Mac, we can simply copy the one line of code that we have here, and we can run that in a terminal window. Once we have our terminal window, we just copy-paste the line, and then we wait. In this case, we want to proceed, so I reply yes or Y. And depending on your computer, this might take something from 10 to 15 seconds to maybe even a minute or two. So be patient at this stage. In this case, Python has updated some of the existing packages that needed to be updated in order for Cartopy to be installed correctly. Once the process has been completed, your terminal prompt will appear on the screen. Cartopy makes it easy to draw maps, and it seems to work well on multiple platforms. We should point out that there are some other libraries for working with maps, but some of them don't work on both Mac and Windows platforms, and others can be more difficult to use. Here we're using just some of the very basic features of Cartopy, and you can explore more features on your own. We'll first perform two standard imports. To move forward, we need to specify a specific projection that we're interested in using. Cartopy provides several different projection alternatives. In this case, we'll be using one of the standard projections. Our next task is to loop over all of the birds and plot their projected trajectories on the map. The code looks very similar to what we had before. We're first looping over all of our bird names. Then we're extracting the rows from our data frame that correspond to that particular bird. Then we extract the longitude and latitude in variables x and y. The final line, the plot line, is what introduces the transformation. In this case, we're using a specific transformation from CCRS. We also want to set up a new figure at the beginning. Finally, we need to set the extent of our axes on the map. This is something that's found usually by trial and error. Before we can call our axes on the final line, we actually first have to create that. We can do that after we've created the figure using PLT axes. Finally, we'll display the legend and we'll save this as map.pdf. We can then try running our code. We can then look for our map. In this case, we can see the flight trajectories as before, but in this case, we've used an actual cartographic projection. That means that these correspond to an actual map. In fact, we can superimpose a map on top of this. We can add some more features to our plot. For example, we can add land, borders of countries, and so on. In this case, I'm adding four different lines. These four lines add land masses, oceans, coastlines, and borders of countries to the map. We can now rerun our code and take a look at it. Looking at the flight trajectories superimposed on top of a map gives us much more insight about the migratory patterns of these birds. We've just looked at some very basics of how to visualize bird flights obtained from GPS data. We have prepared some additional exercises for you to continue investigating flight paths in more detail. Have fun.